sermon is based on Hebrews chapter 9, verses 24 through 28. We'll begin with this prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. It seems like we spend our whole lives waiting. We're all waiting for Halloween, just so we could get to Thanksgiving. We're all going to wait for Thanksgiving, really just so we can get to Christmas. We wait for Christmas, New Year's, and it's just on and on. Spend your whole life waiting. That day where you'll have your first day of school, then you're waiting, get your driver's license, your first car, you start dating, graduate, and maybe go to college, or start an apprenticeship, or start a little business. You're hoping to find somebody that you can marry. You want to wait to have kids. You wait to move out of the apartment to the new home, and then to the bigger home. You wait to get a job, and then you wait to get the dream job. You wait for the kids to move out. You wait to retire. You wait to retire so you can travel. And finally, you wait to get put into a home. And then, waiting stops. When the waiting stops, you face judgment. And some people wait eagerly for judgment day, while others do not. When you do something wrong, you know judgment is coming. You do something wrong, you know that what you found out will be judgment. It happens when mom says you can't have any candy until you go trick-or-treating that night. Or grandma says you can't have any turkey until the Thanksgiving meal. Or dad says you can't open any of your presents until Christmas morning. But then you disobey and you sneak some candy. You sneak a little piece of turkey on the back side that they won't see, or you take a small present from the back. And then there's that time period where you enjoy what you did. Enjoy the candy, the turkey, the present. And this goes beyond those small things. There are things that we do in life, we disobey, we break the rules, and there's a period where we might enjoy that. Sometimes it lasts a long time. Small things and big things in life. But eventually, you have to face judgment when you disobey. When you do something wrong, there's always a punishment. The person finds out, they punish you, or sometimes the person finds out, and then you have to wait. You have to think of what the punishment's going to be. Sometimes that is almost just as bad as the punishment that they come up with. Wait, what are they going to do? In the Old Testament, God was very clear with his people. These are the things that I want you to do. If you do these things, you will be good. You'll be showing love to me, showing love to one another, serving me, serving others. It will be good. God was very clear with Israel what his expectations were. But repeatedly, they disobeyed him. They went against God. They didn't love God. They hurt one another. They didn't show love to one another. And in the Old Testament book of Malachi, God shares what those consequences are finally going to be for those that disobey. Surely the day is coming, it will burn like a furnace. All the arrogant, every evildoer will be stubble. That dry stuff that just a spark hits it, boom, it sets ablaze. That day is coming, will set them on fire, says the Lord Almighty. Not a root nor branch will be left to them. The day was coming. They'd wait for it. The day was coming when they would face judgment for their disobedience. They would be punished with God's all-consuming anger, fire. Fire and judgment. Those who have done what is good will rise to live. Those who have done what is evil will rise to be condemned. God did not want that day to happen. He didn't want people to be in their graves. He didn't want people to die. He didn't want there to be two different groups, the good and the evil. He wanted everyone to live. And he wanted everyone to be good. That's how he created everything, the heavens and the earth and all that fills them. In Genesis chapter 1, after God had finally created Adam and Eve and finished all of his creation, God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. In the other days he said this is good, but finally when everything was completed, he said this is very good. There was no sin at that time. That's what God is getting at. There was perfect love and peace and harmony between God and Adam and Eve, between Adam and Eve themselves. It was perfect, a paradise. That's what God wanted. And he wanted that to continue for every generation, for everybody to live and be good and enjoy living with God. And then Adam and Eve, they disobeyed. They turned from God and they followed the devil. And there was judgment then. And that disobedience has now been passed down generation to generation. So that you were conceived disobedient, born disobedient. Because of that disobedience, that sin, one day you will face God's judgment. Because you are disobedient and you do disobedient things. But God never wanted there to be a judgment day. God never wanted you to live in fear of him and his anger. God never wanted you lost in sin and death. So God made a plan to save you. He shares the details of that plan in the New Testament book of Hebrews. In the book of Hebrews, God uses the Old Testament tabernacle as a picture to show the detail of how he saved you. We'll start with a refresher on what the Old Testament tabernacle was. In the Old Testament, God told the people of Israel to make a tabernacle, which is really just a fancy word for a tent. It's this large tent, not a permanent structure, something that could be taken down and set up and moved around. That was the tabernacle. It was made up of two rooms. There's a front, larger space called the Holy Place, and a smaller back room called the Most Holy Place. They were separated by a very thick curtain. God did this in order to show his presence among his people. God would come down and make his presence visible to them by resting in the most holy place. But again, people were sinful and disobedient. And so they could not approach God or they would die. They would get the punishment that their sins deserved. And so, God set up the priesthood. He's a go-between. Someone to represent the people of God and God to the people. And there was one high priest every year that could enter that most holy place. That one day per year was called the Day of Atonement. One day a year, only one person from an entire country, an entire people and nation, could enter the most holy place, just one person. This was God showing the people that he was good and holy and they were sinful. The only way that that high priest could enter that holy place was with a sacrifice. He made a sacrifice and then he brought that blood in and offered it to God so he could stand in his presence. He also made a separate sacrifice for the people and he brought that in and offered it to God, so that God would not be angry with the people. His anger against their sin would be taken out on that substitute sacrifice. The Day of Atonement, that word atonement means to take away somebody's anger. You give something so that they aren't angry anymore. This sacrifice was given. Blood was shed so that people would be able to be in God's presence. better sacrifice. Not an Old Testament sacrifice, not a sacrifice of an animal, but a better sacrifice. A sacrifice to save you from judgment day. In verse 24 of Hebrews 9, we read, "For Christ did not enter a sanctuary made with human hands that was only a copy of the true one. He entered heaven itself, now to appear for us in God's presence." The tabernacle, that tent, was man-made. God told them to make it, and this was to serve as a copy, an illustration of better things. It was to illustrate how to enter heaven, how to enter God's presence, how to enter eternal life. We read Jesus did not enter that tabernacle. He did not enter something earthly and man-made. He entered something better. He entered heaven itself, the real thing. Jesus entered heaven and he ripped that curtain. So that you now have direct access to God. You have direct access to eternal life with God. Jesus stands in heaven now. He is there permanently, standing between you and God, serving, as we talked about a few weeks ago, that great high priest. Throughout Scripture, there was only one great high priest, and that's Jesus. He stands there as the sacrifice himself, a good sacrifice, so that now when you face judgment and God looks at you to determine whether you are good or evil, he does not look at you, but he stares at Jesus, who is good and perfect and without sin. So when he looks at you, he sees you as good and perfect, worthy to be in his presence, worthy to enjoy eternal life with him. When you face judgment day, God's verdict is not guilty. In verses 25 and 26 we read, "Nor did he enter heaven to offer himself again and again, the way the high priest enters the most holy place every year with blood that is not his own. Otherwise, Christ would have had to suffer many times since the creation of the world. But he has appeared once for all at the culmination of the ages to do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself." Again, in the Old Testament, in the tabernacle, the high priest had to go in every year and do the same sacrifice. In other words, it never worked. That sacrifice never really worked because he had to repeat it over and over again. It didn't satisfy God's anger, and it didn't satisfy the people. It didn't give them a satisfying existence with God. Jesus entered heaven. That's the real goal. Not for all of us to crowd into this dark, small room in this tent, but to enter heaven, to be with God in existence forever. Jesus went there, to heaven itself, with his perfect sacrifice, with his own blood shed for you. He stands there. Permanently, never to be repeated, never to leave. He has arrived. There is no more waiting. He did this to save you from your sins, to save you from the fear of judgment day, to remedy that guilt that weighs heavily on your heart. He did to save you from death and hell. From a hopeless existence, he has saved you from all of that. One sacrifice for Jesus. Hold on to that life that you have. Hebrews 9 makes clear what we are waiting for through Jesus. Verses 27 and 28, "Just as people are destined to die once, and after that face judgment, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many. And he will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him." It's true here in Hebrews chapter 9, says, "You will die, and I will die, and you will face judgment. But Jesus died for your sins. So I will die, and you will face receive life and not death. We hear Jesus say in John chapter 5, "Very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life." Has it. And will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. Your faith in Jesus means you are ready for his return. You are ready for judgment day, the end of time, the end of this world. You are ready for that day because it will bring you full enjoyment of the salvation Jesus has won for you. At this point, all of us are still waiting for that day. And so we're holding on to hope. One day, we'll get this full enjoyment. And that hope keeps us going. And it gives us purpose. It gives us something to share. But one day, you won't need hope anymore. Because you will be with God, permanent. Standing with him in heaven to fully enjoy life. In Malachi chapter 4, God paints a beautiful picture of what that joy will be like for you on judgment. But for you, you who revere my name, the sun of righteousness will rise with healing in its rays. You will go out and frolic like well-fed calves. The healing. The every need met feeling. But no more waiting that you will experience on Judgment Day and beyond is a joy that you cannot imagine. It is a joy that will be yours in Jesus. It seems like we spend our lives waiting for things. And when you're waiting, it means that there's something missing in your life. When you're waiting, it means you need one more thing to make your life complete to be satisfying. Maybe you're waiting into the next grade in school, and you're waiting to hear back on a test to determine your future at school, at college, at company. Maybe you're waiting to just get that promotion. Life will be better. Maybe you're waiting to meet that special someone. Then I can start life. Then I can be fulfilled. Maybe you're waiting to have kids. Maybe you're wondering if the child that you're waiting for now will be healthy. Maybe you're waiting for a difficult situation to end. Maybe you're waiting for a divorce to get resolved. Maybe you're waiting on adoption papers. You're waiting for a chronic illness that you suffer with or somebody that you love suffers with. You're all waiting for things. Yeah, lots of small things, but there's big things that you're waiting for.